Donna. Donna Stone, and I created this piece. And we'll introduce ourselves after the production. Supposed to go to the next slide. There we go. Presenting
Black is Beautiful, a history of African Americans.
A Reader's Theater adaptation by Donna Stone.
And sponsored by IVCC and the Streeter Public Library.
Every winter in the United States, we observe two different holidays honoring African Americans.
Martin Luther King's birthday on the second Monday in January.
And Black History Month in February.
But why is it so important to honor this group of people who emigrated here from Africa when America is known as the melting pot, a land of immigrants hailing from many different countries and cultures?
After all, isn't America known for its freedom of opportunity?
The Declaration of Independence
declared the colonies free from the tyranny of England. Yes, the Declaration of Independence, signed by Benjamin Franklin, George Washington, and written by Thomas Jefferson, states that all men are created equal.
Uh-huh. But what about women and people of color? How were they created?
Exactly.
While most men came freely to the New World to escape poverty and persecution, only Africans were captured from their villages and brought forcibly to this promised land to be sold as slaves.
Considered black gold, this human cargo was treated worse than cattle, as they were prodded and stuffed and chained into the ship's holds. This slide is a diagram of how they were loaded onto the ship.
Here is an account of one African boy captured in 1756 and brought to America, where he was sold into slavery.
My name is Ulade Ikwano, which means good fortune. I was the youngest of seven children in the African kingdom of Benin.
Today, that country is called Nigeria.
One day, my sister and I were guarding the house when three strangers climbed over the wall without being observed. They captured us. It took many days to reach the Atlantic Ocean, where there was a large ship. On board, to my horror, I was handled and tossed up to see if I was a sound body. I was persuaded that I had gotten into a world of bad spirits and that they were going to kill me. Instead, I was flung below deck. The odor of so many people living in their own waste was so bad I could not eat. When I refused food, I was tied down and beaten. I did not understand what was happening to me or why. I was told we were being taken to the white man's country to work. I feared I would be put to death. I had never seen such instance of brutal cruelty. One white man was flung so unmercifully with a large rope that he died, and his body was thrown overboard.
Almost half of every cargo of slaves died during the six-week journey across the Atlantic. However, Ulade did survive. The voyage was later sold to a British naval officer. Unlike most slaves, he was allowed to read and write.
At the age of 21, he was able to buy his freedom.
His autobiography was published when he was 40 years old. It became one of the first personal accounts of being captured, sold, and enslaved. It became a bestseller. Ulade devoted the rest of his life to eliminating slavery.
It was legal to own slaves. The early colonists, especially those living in the South, growing cotton and tobacco, discovered that slaves were the cheapest forms of labor.
Even George Washington and Thomas Jefferson owned slaves.
In the words of Thomas Jefferson, "Blacks are inferior, not totally human. Therefore, blacks can experience love in ways that inspire the imagination. Therefore, they couldn't write poetry."
So how could one explain Phyllis Wheatley, who was brought to America when she was only 9, still missing her two front teeth? Her first name came from
Her name was not even her own.
Her first name came from the name of a slave ship that dragged her to America, and her last was the name of her masters, John and Mary Wheatley. Her poems were about freedom, faith, and God. They were also about the growing tensions between England and the colonies. Sometimes they were about the death of children. Here is one of her freedom poems written in 1722.
Should you, my lord, while you peruse my song, wonder from whence my love of freedom sprung? By feeling hearts alone best understood, I, young in life, by seeming cruel fate, was snatched from Afric's fancied happy seat. What pangs, excruciating, must molest? What sorrows labor in my parents' breast? Steeled, that should, by no misery moved, that from a father seized his babe beloved. Such was my case. And can I then but pray that others may never feel tyrannic sway?
Phyllis was paraded before society in Boston. She even had an audience with George Washington in 1776. She was taken to London, where publishers and critics praised her poems, but she was never set free until the death of the Wheatleys. She then married, had three babies, who all died in babyhood. She got divorced, died in poverty at the age of 31. Even 100 years after her death, she was still known as
the mother of black literature in America.
Often slaves were separated from their families.
They were forced to work long hours for no pay.
Their food consisted of scraps and leftovers.
Their clothing was rags and hand-me-downs.
Music became a way to ease their misery. Gotta jump down, turn around, pick a bale of cotton. Gotta jump down, turn around, pick a bale a day. Gotta jump down, turn around, pick a bale of cotton. Gotta jump down, turn around, pick a bale a day. Oh Lordy, pick a bale of cotton. Oh Lordy, pick a bale a day. Oh Lordy, pick a bale of cotton. Oh Lordy, pick a bale a day.
Instead of the beautiful plantations in which their owners lived, slaves were forced to inhabit tiny cabins with dirt floors. They were not permitted to marry or have families. Education was forbidden, and it was considered illegal to read or write.
Cruelty was common.
Slaves were often whipped or tortured, and there were no laws to protect them. Again, music was their salvation and their way out of their misery. In fact, they often communicated secretly through their music. Here is an old slave spiritual. Joshua fought the battle of Jericho. One, two,
three. Joshua fought the battle of Jericho. Jericho, Jericho. Joshua fought the battle of Jericho, and the walls came tumbling down.
Many slaves, desperate for freedom, tried to run away. And if they succeeded, why, they escaped through rivers and swamps, like those shown in this picture. They could sometimes hide in swamps along river banks, in forests, and in mountains. And sometimes they were permitted to hide in Native American villages.
Renowned black leader Frederick Douglass began life as a slave. He was sold to three different masters. The last was a cruel farmer. He beat Douglas until wealth stood out on his back. Scars he carried for the rest of his life. He wrote an autobiography in which he stated,
"We worked in all weathers. It was never too hot or too cold. It could never rain, blow, hail, or snow too hard for us to work in the field. Work, work, work. The longest days were too short for Master Covey, and the shortest nights were too long for him."
Finally, Douglas stood up to the man. They wrestled nonstop for over 2 hours. Covey never touched him again. Douglas proclaimed,
"I was nothing before. I am a man now."
And yet, it was another 6 months before Douglas was able to escape. He was 20 years old and disguised as a sailor.
"Why am I a slave? I will not stand it. I have only one life to lose, and I might as well have been killed running as die standing. How I escaped death, I do not know."
But escaping was extremely dangerous. They were pursued by slave catchers with vicious hound dogs. There were rewards offered for their capture.
And the Fugitive Slave Act stated that any person caught helping a slave to escape could be fined up to $1,000 and jailed for up to 6 months.
But the slaves grew more determined, and feelings against slavery grew stronger. Between 1820 and 1860, over 100,000 slaves escaped from the North.
Henry Brown, nicknamed Box, was an ingenious slave who mailed himself north to freedom in a shipping crate. Following an excerpt from a letter written by James McCune in the anti-slavery office in Philadelphia.
"Why, here is a man who has been the hero of one of the most extraordinary achievements I have ever heard of. He came to me on a Saturday morning last in a crate tightly marked, this side up. Why, did you ever hear of anything in your life to beat that? I had been expecting him for several days, and I was in mortal fear all the time, lest his arrival should only be a signal for calling the coroner. Huh. Oh, you can better imagine that I can describe my sensations when in my answer to my rap on the box and my question, 'All right,' the prompt answer came,
'All right, sir.'"
Abolitionists were people who felt that slavery was wrong. They worked to help slaves escape and change the laws permitting slavery. They started the Underground Railroad. This is not a train type of railroad. Rather, it was a group of people from south to north that helped the slaves escape to freedom.
Probably the most famous person guiding the Underground Railroad was Harriet Tubman. She was an escaped slave herself, who went back south 14 times to help guide more than 300 slaves to freedom. She was often called
the Moses of her people.
"Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land.
by the runaways as they crept to freedom.
Whoops.
Way in the water, way.
Trouble the water.
If you get to heaven,
Blacks are gonna trouble the water.
Tell all God's people I'm coming soon.
Gods are gonna trouble the water. Wait in the water. Wait in the water, children. Wait in the water. Gods are gonna trouble the water.
Authors also wrote about the horrors of slavery. The most powerful book written was called Uncle Tom's Cabin. It was written by Harriet Beecher Stowe. President Lincoln called Mrs. Stowe
the little woman who wrote the book that made this great war.
Southern states from leaving the Union. It was, and still is, the only war actually fought between the states.
White against white,
brothers against brother,
Northern states against Southern states.
This slide of political cartoon depicts a slave in chains, pleading.
Am I not
a man
and a brother?
Today we like to think that the Civil War was fought to free the slaves. However, it wasn't until President Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation in 1862, a full 2 years after the start of the Civil War, that the slaves were freed. It stated,
all persons held as slaves within any state are now and henceforth forever free.
Yet amazingly, the 13th Amendment officially freeing the slaves throughout the United States was not passed a full two years later after the Emancipation Proclamation. Until that, freedom could be repealed.
But even so, after the Emancipation Proclamation, thousands of African Americans in the South escaped to Union Army camps, carrying all their belongings. They followed the Northern soldiers wherever they went. For the first time, former slaves were offered the opportunity to select their own surname. Until this time, they had to bear the last name of their owner. Some kept those names, but most did not.
Growing up in Savannah, Georgia, slave Susie Taylor figured that reading and writing must be important, or their masters wouldn't be trying so hard to keep them from learning. She states,
every morning we'd step out of the house pretending to go learn a farm trade. Once out of sight, we'd make a beeline to the most dangerous of places, an ordinary classroom. It was run by a widowed friend of my grandma. We went each day about 9 a.m. with our books wrapped in paper to prevent the police or white people from seeing them. We went one at a time through the gate to the kitchen. She had 20 or 30 children whom she taught. When the teacher ran out of new words to teach me, a white girl offered to give me lessons, if I promised not to tell her father.
Later, Susie would work with the Union Army to teach black soldiers to read and write. She also became a nurse. When the first unit of black soldiers, the 54th Massachusetts Regiment, led a bayonet assault on the Confederate Fort Wagner, many were horribly wounded. Susie was one of the nurses.
It is strange how we are able to see the most sickening sights without a shudder, and instead of turning away, how we hurry to assist in alleviating their pain.
binding their wounds and pressed cool water to the parched lips with feelings of only sympathy.
Finally, the war was over.
The slaves were guaranteed freedom in the 13th Amendment.
For the first time, African Americans could receive pay for their labors.
I was only 17 when the war ended. I opened a school for black children, charging families $1 a month. Now, despite all hindrances, my people are striving to attain the full standard of all other races born free in the sight of God.
For the first time, couples can marry and live together as a family.
But many of the former slave owners were angry over the outcome of the Civil War. They wanted to punish African Americans. So they formed the Ku Klux Klan in 1867 to establish their own form of justice. They wore hoods over their heads and terrorized blacks for anything out of line. This included
being out in the streets after dark,
trying to vote,
looking a white person in the eye.
Unfortunately, that group is still in existence today. Fortunately, they have less and less power.
After 1877, when federal troops left the South, there was no protection for the blacks. Harsh new laws were passed in southern states to restrict the freedom of the blacks. Thousands moved away. They moved up north and west. Though food was scarce and winter snows deep, few returned to the South.
Also, what developed was segregation.
There were black neighborhoods
and white neighborhoods,
black schools
and white schools,
even black churches
and white churches.
But most disturbing and degrading were the signs. Blacks had to use separate entrances to movie theaters, they could not eat at a white restaurant, and they were not allowed to use the white public restroom.
And as everyone knows, blacks were not permitted to sit in the front of a public bus. They had to sit in the back. Even then, if a white person wanted their seats, the black had to surrender it.
Get out of my seat!
And that's the way it was for the next 100 years.
But separate was not equal.
African Americans had such a hard life that one of their few joyous celebrations was at a funeral. At last, a person was put out of their misery.
But when the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in,
migration from south to north. Black journalist Vernon Jarrett described a game he and his friends used to play in Tennessee. It was called Conductor, and it went like this.
All aboard!
Who's getting off in Memphis?
We're not getting off in Memphis.
Who's getting off in Nashville?
We're not getting off in Nashville.
No, let me off in Chicago.
That's where we want to be.
The all-black newspaper, The Defender, was founded in Chicago in 1905. It contained letters of people looking to find work in Chicago.
I could do any work that comes to my hands to do so.
I'm a 15-year-old girl from New Orleans who is looking for work so I could help my mother.
I would like to get me a job in a private family so I can continue taking piano lessons. I can do anything around the house but drive, and I can learn that quick. Send me the name of the best high school in Chicago.
Southern white employers, afraid that their laborers would disappear to the north, began punishing blacks caught with copies of The Defender. Why, one Georgia boy was even murdered for selling it.
In the 1920s, following World War I, America experienced prosperity that included the African Americans. Dubbed the Harlem Renaissance, jobs were plentiful, even for blacks. The arts were supported. Pictured here is jazz pianist
Scott Joplin. Washington, D.C. However, audiences were not yet integrated.
Blacks played to black audiences and whites played to white audiences.
The DAR heard that there was going to be an integrated audience, why they canceled her appearance.
But when Eleanor Roosevelt heard about this, she and President Roosevelt invited her to sing on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. A crowd of 75,000 heard her sing.
An audience of both blacks and whites.
Later, she became the first black person to perform at New York's Metropolitan Opera House.
Poets Langston Hughes and Gwendolyn Brooks also broke the color barrier with their hard-hitting poetry. Here is an excerpt of Langston's poem.
Democracy.
Democracy will not come today, this year, nor ever, through compromise and fear.
I have as much as right as the other fellow has to stand on my own two feet and own the land.
When World War II began, blacks were still discriminated against in the armed forces. They were segregated from the white soldiers.
However, the Chanute Air Base Field was one of the first military installations to be partially integrated in 1941. Well, that's because it's where a squadron of famous black soldiers actually began their technical, mechanical, and armored training at the massive Army Air Corps Base facility based in Rantoul, Illinois. They soon became known as the Tuskegee Airmen when their assignment led them to Alabama. They were not in Illinois long because it was expected that it would take the African Americans 3 years to complete what it took whites 1 year to learn. Why, instead, it took less than 1 year. And they had the highest cumulative grade point averages of any other group stationed at the base. These brave men are recognized today, earning over 1,000 medals between them.
More than any other unit.
As the Tuskegee Airmen forged their way for blacks to fly missions in the Army Air Force, another group of blacks near the Tuskegee Institute were actually used as human guinea pigs from 1932 to 1972.
40 years.
Rural sharecroppers were promised free health care, meals, and burial expenses if they participated in medical research study conducted by the Public Health Service at the Tuskegee Institute. Over 600 people who participated in the study, 400 had already been diagnosed with syphilis.
200 were disease-free at the beginning of the study. They were told they were being studied for bad blood. However, even though there was a cure for syphilis, the men were never treated.
More recently, it was revealed that a black woman named Henrietta Lacks had a rare genetic phenomenon, cells that multiplied infinitely.
Although these cells were used in countless medical experiments that led to new discoveries, treatments, and drugs, neither Henrietta nor her family were ever informed, nor were they ever paid for the use of her cells. In addition to these indignities, blacks also faced discrimination up north. They were housing restrictions and other forms of segregation. Even when they served in the CCC, the Civilian Conservation Corps, which provided housing during the Depression in exchange for public service, blacks were housed separately from the whites.
Now everybody knows that Rosa Parks was the first to challenge the bus segregation laws, don't they?
But she really wasn't. 9 months earlier, on March 2, 1955, a 15-year-old girl by the name of Claudette Colvin was actually the first to keep her seat. She claimed,
"When it comes to justice, there is no easy way to get it. You can't sugarcoat it. You have to take a stand and say, this is not right."
The bus driver yelled,
"Hey, get up!"
I just sat there. I didn't speak or move.
"I'm not driving till you get up."
Get up!
"Why don't you get up, girl?"
"I don't have to get up. It's my constitutional right."
Huh.
Claudette was hauled off by the bus by three policemen, taken to jail, and charged with violating the Constitution law, disorderly conduct, and assaulting an officer. She was placed on probation for a year, and when asked why she wouldn't move, she answered,
"Because we were treated wrong, dirty, and nasty."
So why didn't she become the face of the bus boycott?
It wasn't until 9 months later that Reverend Martin Luther King declared,
Enough is enough.
Rosa Parks, a middle-aged factory worker, also refused to give up her seat. She too was arrested. It felt that her arrest as a middle-aged factory worker could affect people more than the angry teenager.
King organized a protest that included the entire black community. They started a boycott of the Montgomery, Alabama bus system. It lasted about a year. And since blacks were the majority of the riders on the buses, the boycott definitely hurt the bus income. That boycott became the catalyst for the entire civil rights movement.
Dr. King believed in nonviolent protest, like those of Mahatma Gandhi in India. He did not believe in using violence or force to stop segregation.
Instead, he organized peaceful marches to make people aware of unfair laws and practices. Participants were carefully trained not to respond to slurs, objects thrown, abuse, or arrests.
Besides marches, protesters organized sit-ins at restaurants, barbershops,
and bus stations.
Sit-ins were held at any place where black people were not permitted. Once again, music was a guiding spirit of the movement. "We Shall Overcome" was the song most associated with the civil rights movement.
We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome.
Discriminated were not.
Violence erupted.
They threw rocks and eggs. White policemen arrested the protesters, not those causing the violence. Here is a picture of the violence in Chicago during the King March.
Probably the scariest, and the bravest of the activists were those who braved isolation and violence to integrate schools. Pictured here is Elizabeth Eckford, one of the Little Rock Nine. As she faced the mob on her way to school that first day, the students persisted in spite of bullying and heckling. All nine went on to be the first blacks to graduate Little Rock High School.
Sorry. One of the persons heckling and shouting at Elizabeth was a woman named Hazel Bryan Massery. She is wearing the white dress behind Elizabeth. 5 years later, ashamed of herself, she called Elizabeth to apologize. She said,
"I grew up in a segregated society. I thought that was the way it was, and the way it should be. I don't want to pass this on to another generation."
Another little girl sat in first grade by herself for the entire year before white parents would let their children be in her class. She was very brave and very lonely. In 1968, Dr. King shown here with civil rights activists Jesse Jackson and Ralph Abernathy was shot at this very spot by assassin James Earl Ray.
His loss was the nation's loss.
He did so much to inspire both black people and white people to live and work together.
His most famous speech was,
"I have a dream."
This speech was presented at the march in Washington, D.C. in 1963. More than 225,000 people were crowded into the Capitol Mall as he uttered these words.
I have a dream
that one day sons of former slaves and sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood.
I have a dream that little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of skin, but by the content of their character.
I have a dream that one day, little black boys and little black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and little white girls as brothers and sisters.
2013 marked the 50th anniversary of the Civil Rights speech. Has there been progress in those 50 years? Are African Americans finally accepted for who they are rather than the color of the skin?
Have we become a colorblind society?
Sometimes.
There has been some progress.
In every field, spectacularly talented blacks are earning their rightful places and achieving amazing goals and feats in so many areas.
Baseball great Jackie Robinson was the first African-American baseball player to make the major league. He suffered many indignities, but persisted and will be forever remembered for the barriers he overcame.
At the 2012 London Olympics, teenager Gabby Douglas became the first black gymnast to win the overall championship. Her bubbly personality captured the hearts of the entire world.
Sisters Serena and Venus Williams not only became the first black women's tennis champions, but they have continued to wow the world, winning championship after championship for many years. And though the sisters compete, they also support one another to the fullest.
We have become colorblind to our musicians and movie stars, long admiring the talent of so many African Americans. Pictured here.
Meanwhile, Chicago-born Chance the Rapper has become known for his generosity as well as his musicianship.
Oprah Winfrey pulled herself out of poverty and abuse and has become the most successful businesswoman and entertainer of all time. Many are hoping she will throw her hat in the ring and run for president of the United States.
Last but certainly not least, we bring you the first African-American president of the United States. Not only was he the first black president, but he was elected for 2 terms.
Barack Obama.
As popular as she is, do you think Michelle Obama will attempt to capture the Oval Office? Just think, if she won, she would be the first woman.
And the first black woman president of the United States of America.
And I just want to throw in something. If any of you followed the Chicago elections last night, the two that will be in the runoff are both African American women. To continue. Oh, it's me. But there is still more to be done. Unfortunately, Chicago's pockets of poverty are still predominantly black and Hispanic. We remain segregated on the basis of our educational and economic developments and achievements.
It is predicted by 2020, the next census, 60% of Americans will be of color.
African American.
Hispanic. Indian.
Asian.
Middle Eastern.
And First Peoples or Native Americans.
We must all learn to live together and love together to bring about world peace.
Donna. Thank you again for coming. Hope you enjoyed this. And hopefully we'll see you next month when we're doing a program about the suffragettes, which are celebrating their centennial of the passage of the 19th Amendment. That'll be the after spring break, the middle of March. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Does anybody have any questions?
How did you guys all like meet and get into this? Like, how was this formed?
Where you guys slept off?
Donna?
Kathy, Connie, and I are in a group called the Drama Mamas. And we do primarily readers' theater that deal with women's issues. Latrice was in my speech class last semester, and she dragged Brian into joining us. And Allie is the significant other of Connie's son. So we all kind of mixed and matched and got together.
So where do you teach?
For IV.
Really?
I teach speech and theater at the Ottawa Center.
Oh, okay, usually. I felt really bad. I was like, I've never been to the Ottawa Center. I've never seen you before, so I felt so bad.
Don't feel bad, it's okay. A few people find me. Oh, and if you know anybody who wasn't able to come today, we are performing at the Ottawa Center tonight at 6:30, and tomorrow night at the Streeter Library at 6:30. And you're all welcome to come back, but send some people and, our way.
And the suffragettes, too. The suffragettes program.
We got flyers. Watch for the flyers for that.
I got a couple.
And does anybody have children? Because we have a, I have a kids group that is performing on Monday at Dr. Seuss-a-thon. So if anybody would like a flyer for that, I'd be happy to give it to you.
There's a suffragettes flyer, too. That's going to be interesting.
You want to come to that?